I've already welcomed all of you, but I do want to welcome those of you who are going to be joining us online. We just want to welcome you and are glad that you could be a part of this current series we're going through called Table. And so I need to set the table for talking about a table by saying that I lied to you last week. I know. Thank you. I appreciate that. I received that gift of forgiveness. You don't even know what I lied about yet, though. I lied to you last week, and I need to correct myself, okay? And so, let me just say it like this. Your pastor, this is going to surprise you, has issues. Some of my issues are around planning and ensuring that my plans to get things done happen how I anticipated those plans to get done. I'll give you two examples really quick. I love to spend time traveling as just a family unit. It could be like a one-day thing that we do as a family. It could be a weekend thing. It could be a week thing, a two-week thing. Whatever it is, I love planning for these times and these little trips or getaways we make as a family. And I do everything in my power to ensure the plan comes together, including the plan to depart at a particular time. And I have things ready. Oh, let me tell you, I have things ready so that things will go just as smoothly as possible to inevitably get to a moment where one of the Fisher Four is not ready to follow that plan and is delayed. And while the three of us wait in the truck for her, five, 10, 15, 20, sometimes up to 45 minutes, you know, my soul in the midst of my planning gets a little aggravated. And my union with Jesus in those moments is tested. I'll give you another example. I genuinely like to cook and host groups of people. I don't get to do as much as I like these days because I'm just in a season, and many of you have been in the season I am, right? Where you got your life, your work, you got church life, you've got kids' activities. So it's a little harder than normal, but I do like it. And when I do, I'm usually in my mind prepping my plans to be ready for a particular time, right? And so the prepping food is easy. You apply flavor, spice, whatever, add heat, and you keep going. But it's that time you're supposed to be ready, like 5:30, all right? And like prepping one thing, two things, three things, four things, five, six, whatever, along the way. But it's that end time when you need all six things ready at 5:30, right? Where I can get a little bit testy, if you will. And I call the Fisher Four. Now, this is 100% on me. I'll be like, listen, Fisher Four, I need you down here right now. I got six things to get ready. They're going to walk through the door in 2 minutes, and I'm not ready. I need your help. And I just get to this place where I got to get stuff done according to my plan, and it's not happening. I just have these like issues with planning and control and things going how I want because I'm a doer. And this is where I lied to you. Last week, I said to you, something along the lines of like, you know, it's not often my being a doer that, you know, keeps me from my union with Jesus. It's more often it's the wounding in my soul. And I was totally sincere as I said that. And there really is woundings in my soul. Frankly, there's woundings in all of your souls that you need to deal with and process and unpack so that you can have greater union with Jesus. But I kind of sloughed off the doer part of me until I started this week meditating on Mary and Martha from Luke chapter 10 and found myself thinking to myself, that Martha, that's my girl. I get Martha. Like, me and her, we are cut from the same cloth. And in my doing, as long as things are going according to my plan, my union with Jesus is great. But when things don't go according to my plan, my union with Jesus suffers. Many of you are clearly familiar with Mary and Martha. Those of you who are not, let me read it for you, and I'll share with what I'm speaking about and speaking into right here. So I'm going to go to Luke chapter 10 as we consider message 2 and tables, an invitation to union with the King, and we look at a different type of table today. So, Luke 10, 38 to 42, and it reads like this. As Jesus and the disciples continued on their way to Jerusalem, they came to a certain village where a woman named Martha, that's my girl, okay? Just make sure you're tracking with the story. Where a woman named Martha welcomed him, Jesus, into her home. That sounds amazing, doesn't it? Her sister Mary sat at the Lord's feet, listening to what he taught. But Martha was distracted by the big dinner she was preparing. She came to Jesus and said, Lord, doesn't it seem unfair to you that my sister just sits here while I do all the work? Tell her to come and help me. But the Lord said to her, my dear Martha, isn't that such a welcoming? My dear Martha, I love my dear Ken, my dear Martha, sir, you are worried and upset over all these details. There is only one thing worth being concerned about. Mary has discovered it, and it will not be taken away from her. Let's talk about these two ladies in the text. We got Mary, we got Martha, but let's start with Martha. I do genuinely love that opening line of how Martha welcomed Jesus into her home. This is refreshing. Like, let's consider the good parts of who Martha is, all right? Like, she is showing hospitality. She's clearly a woman of hospitality. And you know what? In all honesty, like, especially post-COVID, we've kind of lost the value of hospitality, haven't we? Like, we less and less will have, like, people into our home in these days. But we got to understand, for Martha, in a Hebrew culture, then and even now, the value of hospitality is high. Like, this really and truly mattered, to be able to care for and to love on people that are in your home. And she's truly trying to just be like the best version of who she is. Speaking of the best version, let's give Martha a little credit before we go into the other side of it. In John chapter 11, where Mary and Martha's brother Lazarus dies, it's fascinating that when Jesus finally shows up to the town, who is it that walks or heads out first to meet Jesus? It's Martha. And she just opens up her heart to him. Oh, Lord, if only you had been here. And clearly, she does have a genuine heart and a love and a desire to be with, to know Jesus. So let's give her some credit. But in the text we come to today, Martha, who welcomed Jesus, describes as one who is worried and upset. In particular, she's worried and upset because she's distracted by something. She's distracted by what? A table. Right? Here we find our table of the week. She's distracted by a table. But now this time, it's not the Lord's table that she's distracted by, right? She's distracted by her own table. And Jesus says, your sister has found something better, and describes her as worried and upset. You know what's fascinating is some of you use different translations, and that's great. I don't care what translation of the Bible you read. I just want you to read it. And if you use a different one than I'm using this morning, because I'm going to use a different one later in the message, that's fine. Some of your translations are going to say that Jesus describes her as anxious. I mean, think about that. Worried, upset, anxious. Does that sound like, you know, the world we kind of live in today? Come on now, worried, upset, anxious. I feel like Jesus is talking about like Fort Saskatchewan 2024, isn't he? Worried, upset, anxious. And we're just so quickly moved to these types of emotions, don't we? Now, I don't want to belittle or take away from the value of our mental health. This is important. I told a story last week of me needing a counselor, and so I've spoken into that. But on the flip side, I do want to say, I do honestly feel that a lot of our worries, things that makes us upset and the things that get us anxious are really self-inflicted, aren't they? I think we got to consider that and maybe talk about that a little more. Sometimes our worries, the things we're upset about, things that make us anxious are really self-inflicted. I want to read one quote from an author that I read. He said this. And this is going to be the framework for what we're going to talk about as we get into to Mary as well. What we do with Jesus is far more important than what we do for Jesus. Think about that. What we do with Jesus is far more important than what we do for Jesus. So I was hanging out at the seniors' lunch for a little bit this week. And the seniors' lunch, like, those are my people. All right, I get our seniors. I love them with all my heart, and they always make fun of me when I go down there about getting old. And I say to them, listen, this is a high mileage model, okay? I relate to you. Like, I know a lot of you are the same age as my parents, but like, I get you. I'm high mileage, all right? Like, I probably did way more contact and combat sport than I probably should have over the years. And like right now, I'm not lying, this shoulder hurts, this hip hurts, and this knee hurts as I'm up here walking around. Like, you're my people, okay? Anyways, one of them pulls me aside and says, can I tell you a joke? And I said, of course you could tell me a joke. I need a good joke once in a while. And they start off like this. There was a pastor. Usually when I get there was a pastor, there's some type of self-deprecating humor that's about to come, and I'm good with it. Like, I truly, truly am. But they start off with the line, there was a pastor, and he was invited over to a home for supper, and they had a nice dinner and with the couple that was there, and he went on his way, and as the couple was cleaning up, the lady notices that her favorite spoon is missing, he says. Now, I get it. Like, favorite spoons are a thing, okay? Like, this is legit real, all right? I have my favorite serving spoon. I have my favorite stirring spoon. I have my favorite soup spoon. There's only one in the drawer that's like that, and it's mine. When we're having soup, that's my spoon. Like, it's my favorite. I get it. So I'm relating to the lady in the story here, okay? And she can't find her favorite spoon as they're cleaning up. So she says to her, you know, her husband, like, what's going on? Like, where's the spoon? Like, help me find it. And they look, they can't find it. She's stewing about this all night, apparently. And she gets up the next morning, she looks around again, can't find her favorite spoon. A week goes by, says her husband, that spoon went missing when the pastor was here. I think the pastor stole my spoon. Her husband, no, he didn't steal this spoon. He couldn't spill it. Month goes by, and she's like, that pastor, he had to have taken my spoon. Like, it's gone. Like, that was the day it was gone. Finally, a year goes by, and she's, like, really frustrated, apparently, at this point in the joke. And she comes to the pastor and says, Pastor, I need to know. I can't take anymore. Did you steal my favorite spoon? And the pastor says, no, I didn't steal your favorite spoon. I put it in your Bible. I told the senior who was telling me that joke, I said, I'm using that on Sunday. It fits with what I'm talking about. This works good, all right? He didn't want me to mention his name, you know, get any credit. But this is what I'm talking about, worried, upset, and anxious. And I'm convinced so much of that is self-inflicted Because we got Martha-like issues where we do, and in the midst of our doing, we don't slow enough down enough to do what is most important and spend time with the living, resurrected King. And while a table is distracting Martha, what Jesus is suggesting is that at his table, there is something better. Union with the King. Which brings us to Mary. And what's so cool about Mary is found in a posture of sitting. She sat there with Jesus. I mean, her heart was captivated by Jesus. She just wanted to be around Jesus. And as simple as this sounds, the more I consider Jesus, the gospel, the work he's done on the cross to bring freedom, to bring forgiveness, to bring healing, to bring restoration, the more I get to know him and his heart, the more I want to sit with him because I recognize I got my issues and I want to be with him and see those things calmed in my heart, in my soul. I want to be with him. If you're here with us today and you've yet to like enter into relationship, enter into community, enter into this union with Jesus, the story of Scripture, the God story, starts in such a way where we recognize, we see so clearly that God designed us and wired us for this relationship, for this fellowship, for this communion, for this union with him. But we walked away and followed our own evil desires, our own, you know, addictive tendencies, our own wicked ways. We sinned and walked away from him. And so the God story is the story of God taking on flesh, Jesus coming as a human being. And as a human being walking in such a way, he shows what it looks like to have relationship with God, union with God, communion with him, fellowship with him. And then ultimately he takes on my sin, your sin. He gives his life for you. That if you would come to him and just say, Jesus, I'm sorry. Jesus, forgive me. My life is yours. We'd begin this journey of growing and knowing him, but it starts by coming back into this communion, this union, this fellowship. He wants that for you. It starts with Jesus, I'm sorry. Jesus, forgive me. Jesus, my life is yours. And as I've grown to see how true that is, my heart grows in this place of being captivated and wanting to learn of who he is, of how this God who would come and enter into this mess so that I could have a relationship affects and changes me. And I mean, seriously, this is not me swearing, I swear. Thank God for the sanctification process. Because the last time we went on a trip, right, babe, I sat in the truck and I didn't even say a peep. See? No, I didn't. She said I was really good. She's like, you were so much better this time. Thank you. It's all Jesus sanctifying this broken man. I'm not sure about the boys. I don't remember how they were. But it doesn't matter. Sorry, guys. Anyways, my brother recently gave me a book. I'm almost done with it already. It's a pretty simple book, but it really gives a visual image of what Jesus' heart is for you. The book's called Two Chairs. And the initial premise, and then they build upon it, but the initial premise is that wherever it is that you spend most of your time doing your praying or your reading of your word, and we're going to talk a bit more of that in a moment, is you should set up two chairs so that you literally can sit in your spot and consider that empty chair and recognize that Jesus is sitting right there with you. A two-chair experience. A Mary experience. Where you're recognizing you are sitting with God as you start your day in prayer and in the Word. I am not a master of this, and I've told you, I'm still learning and I'm still growing. But I mean, the last few months, I've had some kind of interesting two-chair experiences of learning to hear the voice of Jesus, the good shepherd who speaks to his sheep. And it was a little while back now, I was sitting in my prayer spot, and I was going through kind of my rhythms, my cadence, my routines, if you will. And it was as if I sensed Jesus in this spot whisper something to me that went like this: Ken, you're going to enter into a dark season. It's going to be okay. Don't worry. It was really clear. That thought came to me. Okay, Lord, I trust you. We press on, and within days, I knew exactly what that meant. Don't worry, though, Ken, don't worry. But our human tendency, isn't it? Worried, upset, and anxious. Fast track a few months, and I'm sitting right here at a table on Tuesday night leading Hearing God. Some of you were a part of that. And we're practicing in Hearing God, reading our Bible. We're practicing listening. We're practicing learning from the Word and trying to hear Jesus in the midst of it. And I shared at one of these Hearing Gods that I sensed in the midst of this time, Jesus say, it's okay, this week I'm going to ease what's going on in your heart and in your mind and your soul. And I shared that with the whole group because I'm trying to practice and get better at this. And then I shared with them the next week, sure enough, Monday, I get an email from a person of influence and significance in what was going on say to me, it's okay, just be at peace. And my soul knew, it's okay. This two-chair reality, this Mary-like sitting with Jesus, being captivated, having your heart be captivated, is so important. And these many of our self-inflicted, you know, worries, things that make us upset, our anxiousness, can be dealt with if we would just not lose the spoon in the Bible, right? And spend time there. Now, what's really cool about this passage is what's worded around all this. Because it specifically says that Mary sat at the Lord's feet. This is actually really significant and actually quite fascinating. And what's the cool part of this, before I get into this, is some of the backstory, is this little mini-series kind of came together in November with Pastor Carlos and I on a walk, considering April 28th as a Sunday. I wanted to have kids on stage with me as I was speaking. We'll get to April 28th on April 28th. But we began to craft this and kind of put this together back then, not knowing that next week was going to be our vote on women potentially serving as elders. So with this as the backdrop, this is really fascinating to me that the timing of this took place, because I just want to highlight what is said here. It says this so very, very clearly. Her sister Mary, I'm at 39, sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he taught. I want to flip over to Acts chapter 22 before I come back to that and make the point. So in the version that I'm using right now, I have the New Living Translation. I like to teach from this because it's very modern English and it flows well and it's easy to understand. And in an environment like that, this is perfect to have a translation that flows well and is easy to understand. So it says this. Paul is kind of making a case for who he is and what he knows and why he's an innocent, God-fearing, Jesus-following man. Then Paul said, I am a Jew born in Tarsus, a city in Cilicia, and was brought up and educated here in Jerusalem under Gamaliel. Educated here under Gamaliel. This is really important because if you go to a more literal translation, it reads like this. I'm a Jew born in Tarsus in Cilicia, but brought up in the city, educated where? At the feet of Gamaliel. First century, this is critical to understand. At the feet of religious leaders and rabbis is where one was taught and trained for ministry. At the feet. And the first century folks, they knew this crystal clear. And here, flipping back to Mary and Martha, you actually have Jesus clearly now training Mary, equipping the willing for ministry. This is why this is so beautiful for us today. Thought out in November, didn't know what April 21st would mean. Wherever you are at in the discussion, whatever perspective you hold today in the midst of us prior to going to a vote, whatever biblical perspective you hold, because you can make strong biblical arguments on either end of the spectrum or either perspective, what we got to know for certain is Jesus has clearly trained women for ministry. And what's really fascinating about this in Jesus' day, this spot, only reserved for men. Only men trained at the feet of the religious leader of a rabbi. But here, Jesus is training, equipping the willing. How beautiful is this? So whatever perspective you're at prior to us coming to next week, what's beautiful of this is this truth that Jesus has empowered and is teaching and is equipping women to lead, and we are blessed by that here, aren't we? So grateful for the women in leadership in the congregation. Many of you, Pastor Amber this morning, Pastor Ashley, it's so incredible that we have such gifted, wonderful women in this fellowship leading and serving, serving us. Speaking of Mary, now there's some debate about this Mary and Mary Magdalene and if they're the same person or not, and that doesn't matter for today, but this Mary is often referred to as Mary of Bethany. And what's really cool about Mary of Bethany is when you look in Scripture and you see Mary of Bethany, guess where you find her three times? Check this out. So we find that she sat at the feet and listened to his word in Luke 10:39. She fell at his feet and shared her woe in John 11:32. And then she came to his feet and poured out her worship in John 12, verse 3. How cool is it that Mary Bethany is always portrayed as the feet of Jesus? That is cool. Which brings us back to our need, our response to the worries, the things that makes us upset, and the anxiety that are so self-imposed. What then, as a result, are our rhythms, our cadences, kind of our routines that help us to sit at the feet of Jesus, to be equipped as our hearts are just captivated by him. I mentioned this last week. If I was going to teach a seminary class or a college class on pastoral leadership, lesson two, what was going to be off last week, which was that you were a sheep before your shepherd. But I said lesson one would definitely be abide. Abide, 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 abide. And lesson one is a lesson for all of us. Jesus wants us to abide in him and with him. He wants us to come to his feet, to sit silently, to listen. He wants us to come and to be grateful, for we come into his courts with praise. And he's given us this gift of this book, the Bible, to read and to spend time in. And if you, like me, are still learning to hear the voice of Jesus, I am certain that the number one way you learn to hear Jesus' voice is to read this book. It's authored by him. And as you read this book, as you spend time in this book, he's going to help you and grow you in such a way that you can more clearly listen and hear him in his heart. And as you do that, you're going to discover some things that in your heart is the very throne room in which Jesus resides, where he longs to meet with you and to get to know you, where he longs to speak to you and listen to you. He longs to do that. And so I'm going to take us as a means to wrap up to Ephesians chapter 3. And we're going to just practice one more time, because I really believe this is important. We're going to practice one more time in this space, just sitting with Jesus. And I want to read a passage that speaks of your heart becoming the very throne room that Jesus resides. Because it's a biblical concept, right? As I read this passage, we're going to do an ancient practice called Lectio Divina. We're going to simplify it into four steps. We're going to read, we're going to repeat, we're going to reflect, and we're going to rest. We're going to read, repeat, reflect, and rest. So I'm going to read for you Ephesians chapter 2, 12 to 19. And now as I read this to you, I want you to look for the word or phrase that just seemingly Holy Spirit-led just seems to go poof and pop out for you. It could be a single word, it could be a phrase, it could be a whole verse. Okay, look for one that stands out to you. Ephesians 3, verse 12, starting there. Because of Christ and our faith in him, we can now come boldly and confidently into God's presence. So please don't lose heart because of my trials here. I'm suffering for you, so you should feel honored. When I think of all this, I fall to my knees and I pray to the Father, the creator of everything in heaven and on earth. I pray that from his glorious, unlimited resources, he will empower you with inner strength through his Spirit. Then Christ will make his home in your heart. As you trust him, your roots will grow down deep into God's love and keep you strong. And may you have the power to understand, as all God's people should, how wide, how long, how high, and how deep his love is. May you experience the love of Christ, though it is far too great to understand fully. Then you will be made complete with all the fullness of life and the power that comes from God. Now, whatever your word or your phrase is, I want you to close your eyes. This passage talks about Christ making his home in our heart. I want you to just, in the quietness of this space and in this time, just in your heart, in your mind, within your soul, just envision you and Jesus. Years ago when I was doing this, it was just me in a room filled with light. That's all I could see. Over the years, it's developed to me just sitting in a two-chair-like environment. Me and my King and my Lord, and also my friend. So there's the space, this two-chair experience. You sit at the feet of Jesus. Now, whatever that word or phrase from the Bible, the Word of God was, I want you to repeat it in your mind, okay? So, for me today, it was experience, that you may experience the love of Christ. I'm just going to repeat in my mind, that I may experience the love of Christ, that I may experience the love of Christ. Just repeat that to you. Whatever it was for you, repeat that to yourself. Distracted, just, oh, it's okay. Come back to him. Let me experience the love of Christ. And now we're going to reflect. And so I just want you to ask Jesus, Jesus, why did you highlight this word or phrase for me? Why was it the standout today? Is there anything you need me to let go of? Is there anything you need me to be obedient in? Is there anything you're asking me to trust more fully? As you consider that word or phrase, just rest in that spot, in that moment with you and Jesus, considering just what stood out from his word today. Lord Jesus, thank you that you, the living God, created us. That you, the living God, even though knowing we would walk away, ensured there would be a plan for us to come back into union with you. Thank you that because you are the living God, we today can still, like Mary, sit at your feet. Thank you for the promise, the gift, the seal, the power of the Holy Spirit that leads and guides and directs us in this. Jesus, may our hearts more and more as we consider what you've done be captivated by you. And at your feet, may we, your people, be equipped to